Hi, I'm Rimjhim Bhadani, a final year student at Institute of Engineering and Management. I am a Grasshopper student scholar. I am a Google Venkat Panchpakeshan scholar. I had also been a GSOC student and a GCI mentor. Currently, I'm authoring a book on deploying deep learning models in mobile devices using Flutter. I'm the lead of Developer Student Club at my campus. Also, I led the team that was responsible for building the app of the event today. So we have some members of the app team right now here. The host himself, Piyush. I guess he's not here. Apart from that, we have Aritra. So we can have a round of applause for the app team. I guess all of us have checked out the app. So today, we will start by understanding the topic a bit more. Then we'll see what Firebase ML Kit is, the set of available APIs there. Then we'll look into Firebase Phase Detector. And then we'll look into how we can implement it in Flutter. And at last, we'll see how Firebase ML Kit is benefiting a real-world application. So let's start with scratching the terms that are involved in building the title of the session today. Here, we are talking about building intelligent applications. So what term comes to your mind when you hear the word intelligence? Anyway, okay, so I have some stickers out here. So if you interact and answer the questions, you can get the laptop stickers. So let's go back to the question. What term or technology comes to your mind when you first hear the word intelligence? Yes, thinking ability, artificial intelligence, or say, machine learning models. What do we actually do in machine learning? We build the model, we train it using some training data, and then we pass in the input and get the output or the predictions. Today, we are building mobile applications, so we will also be using a mobile interface. What are the advantages of using a mobile interface? Anyone? Yes? Sorry? Yes, yes. It's widely used, it's handy. So when we bring machine learning models into our mobile applications, the application gets a tendency of adapting to users' data and then helps us in providing much more personalized experience. Now, since we are building mobile applications here, we would also be requiring a development tool. So let's use Flutter. I guess the picture is not coming up. Okay. How many of us know him? And why do we know him? Flutter. So today we will be using Flutter. How many Flutter developers do we have out here? What is your favorite thing about Flutter? Anyone? UI. It helps us in delivering a very good user experience. We can do much more with very less code. So we run into bugs very less, right? Now, at this point, we are using machine learning models in our applications, and we will be using Flutter for that. But what if you as an app developer is not very much comfortable with machine learning? So let's make your life easier and replace the whole complexity behind machine learning with Firebase ML Kit. How many of us know what Firebase ML Kit is? Anyone who can stand up and answer, and please don't answer in a group. I cannot give stickers that way. Anyone?
In Android, we use machine learning with the help of ML Kit, like different feature it has, like a barcode scanner, QR code scanner, a phase detector, a machine learning kind of thing also.
Sure, yes, correct. So Firebase ML Kit, according to the docs, is a machine learning SDK which has a set of available APIs which we can use in our applications to deliver much more enhanced machine learning experience. Let's simplify this definition a bit more. Can we have a support here? How does this work? It's not working. Okay, finally, I skipped one slide. So let's simplify the definition. Yeah, it's stable now. So what Google did is, it created some machine learning models based on common mobile use cases, trained it using the data that has long powered Google's own mobile experiences, optimized them to run smoothly on mobile devices, wrapped them in simple, easy to use APIs, and provided us to use as developers. So the work that remains on your part is just to instantiate them, include them in our code, pass in the input, and get the output or the predictions. All of these APIs are total production ready, so you can directly include it in your code. The set of APIs can run either on device or on cloud. Both of these categories have their own pros and cons. The on-device APIs runs locally on the device, and hence they do not require an active internet connection. Also, the data never leaves the phone, so users' privacy is totally maintained. On the other hand, the cloud APIs use the power of Google Cloud Platform's machine learning experiences to get much more precise results. It would also always require an internet connection. Now we have a set of available APIs. Suppose your use case does not suit any of those APIs. So you can create your own machine learning model and upload it on Firebase. Hosting the model and serving the app will be taken care of Firebase itself. So if you noticed, I said the set of available APIs are based on common mobile use cases. So what, according to you people, would be the most common mobile use cases? Anyone? Like, for what do you use mobiles the most? No, use cases. What have been doing? What have you been doing since the morning? Sorry? Yes, and? Texting, yes. So the available APIs fall under the two categories. Vision, which deals with the images, and the text, which deals with the text that is generated. Right? And all of these are present in abundance in our mobile devices. So let's look at each of them separately. The first category is vision, where we analyze and interpret the images. The set of available APIs are, the first one is barcode scanning, which helps us in scanning the data and extracting it, encoded in very standard barcode formats. The second one is face detection, which he said kind of face unlock. We can detect faces in the images that were passed. We can also get the basic facial features. We will be looking into this API in much more detail in the later slides. The third one is image labeling. It helps us in getting the insights of the image that was passed as an input. So when you pass an image, you get a list of intents, such as people, activities, places, and all of these intents come with a confidence value. What is a confidence value in machine learning terms? Anyone? Like, anyone who has a rough idea or something? Yes?
So it's basically measure of accuracy that whatever the test or the, the algorithm is doing, so it's going to provide a predictive result which is somewhat valid.
Yes, totally. So the intents comes with a confidence value, which specify the confidence the model has in predicting that particular intent. The next one is landmark detection. It helps us in detecting the most famous landmarks present in an image. So when we pass an image as an input, we get a region where the landmark was present in the image, the geographical locations, and some more details about the landmark. Okay. I jumped. The fifth one is text recognition. It helps us in extracting the text present in an image. So suppose you have an image of a credit card and you pass in as an input to the model. You will get a string which represents the number of the credit card, right? So the API basically helps us in extracting the text parts and gets us the text as a string which we can use later in our applications. The last one is object detection. It helps us in locating the prominent objects present in an image. Also, it returns as a handle which we can use to track the images in real time. This was all about vision. The next category we have here, okay, is language, which deals with analyzing and interpreting data present in the form of text, speech, or any other lateral language. The first API that we have here, already visible, is language identification. Very much predictive by the name. So any guesses? No. I'm asking language identification. So what do you understand by the term? Okay, pretty much.
It actually helps to identify the characters and then it can predict with this language. By seeing into the Bangla letter character, it can say, yeah, this is Bangla, and seeing into Hindi letter character, it can say, this is Hindi.
Yes.
That this is the language.
Sure. But you're not collecting stickers, so we won't have another one for you. Let's give chance to other people. So as you said, this API helps us in identifying the language of the string. The next one is on-device translation. Again, very much predictive by the name. It helps us in translating the text from one language to the other. The API works between 53 different languages, and whole of this model works on the device itself. So the context of the text never leaves the device, and hence the user's privacy is maintained. The last one is smart reply. I guess all of us have come across smart reply. So where have we used it the most? Which application? Gmail, yes. Other than that?
Messenger.
LinkedIn, yes. Yes, so the API helps us in generating some more automated replies, which depends on analyzing the whole context of the application. So this was all about the story of ML Kit. Let's now look into how we can implement it in Flutter. So we have three basic steps. The first one, we need to use a dependency, of course. Then, since we are using Firebase, we'll create a project and configure it for different platforms. And at last, we can instantiate the face detector and use it in our code. Let's look at each of them in more detail. Before that, how many Flutter developers? How many of us have used at least one plugin in our application? What is a plugin? Anyone wants to answer? What is a plugin? Yeah. Anyone else?
A plugin is a block of code that is written by someone else and that is import in our code and we don't have to write it separately. separately. That code is taking care of the job that we want to
do. Yes. So the plugins are the features that have been developed by other people and are open sourced. So we can directly use them in our application, and we don't need to develop that feature from scratch once again. So since we are using Firebase ML Kit out here, we will use the plugin Firebase ML Vision. So the convention in Flutter is to first specify the name of the plugin, followed by the version number. Now, if you look at the code a bit carefully, there's a cap symbol before the version number. Why do we use that? We can give... Yes. So what exactly is semantic versioning? Can you give more light on that? So here we have, say we are using a plugin and we want to use a version 0.9.1. But the plugin is again available in more higher versions, say 0.9.2 or 0.9.3. So the cap symbol will help us in fetching the latest version, but then it has an upper bound. It won't ever go beyond the major version number. So the upper bound for this plugin would be 1.0.0. Apart from this, there are other conventions of using plugin or say specifying the version numbers. What's the most favorite one of any of the Flutter developers? We are not required to totally specify the version numbers, right? We can just skip that, right? So anyone wants to say anything about that? Okay, no one loves stickers. So if we don't specify the version numbers here, the compiler which will help us in getting the latest version of the plugins that are available. So suppose we write this and we run Flutter packages get. So now we have the plugin in our application. Next, we need to configure Firebase platform and create a project. So we start by signing up on Firebase, of course. And then we move to the console, and we need to add a project to our application. So when you click the add project, you are directed to a window where you need to specify your project name and some other basic details, and then accept terms and conditions, and then your project will be created. Once the project is created successfully, you'll be directed to a screen where you need to configure the project differently for each of the platforms, say for Android, iOS, or web. So let's look into how we can configure the project for Android. So we start by clicking on the Android icon. Once it's done, the first step that we need to do is register the app. First, we specify the package name here. This package name acts as an ID for the project. We need to be sure that the package name that we are specifying here totally matches with the package name that we have used in a Flutter SDK. Otherwise, there would be problems because this package name is used as an ID. Then we need to provide an app nick. After providing some more security fields, you can register your app. The second step out here is to download googleservices.json file. So how many of us have worked with Firebase? Almost all of us, and have included googleservices.json in our apps, right? So anyone who can answer what googleservices.json is or why do we use it in our applications? Anyone else? Okay.
Interact
Can you please be a bit loud and slow?
It contains all the configuration files for the database link, the Firebase storage links, and all those things.
Yes. So the Google services.json file acts as a point of contact, or say a bridge, between the project that has been created on Firebase console and the project that is available in your Flutter SDK. It has some credentials, API keys, and in case you're using Firebase real-time database, it also contains the URL for the database. So you need to download the file and include it in your app module. Also, it is not recommended to make this file public. Since it contains your API keys, we should always move it to Git ignore versions. So that was all with Firebase console. Next, since we are using Firebase in our applications, we need to add some dependencies related to that. We start by adding Google services dependency in our project level build.gradle file. This helps us in producing resources that we might use for Firebase. Next, we add some more dependencies in our app level build.gradle file. At this point, we are done with configuration of Firebase. So now we have a dependency for ML Vision. We have a project on Firebase console. Also, we have added dependencies so that the project supports Firebase functionalities. So now we are all set to use phase detection in our project. But before that, let's look into what phase detection offers us. So the ML Kit phase detector helps us in recognizing and locating facial features in an image that was passed. So suppose we have an image of one of our most efficient and beloved organizers. So when this image is passed as an input, first of all, it gives a region where the face was detected. Apart from that, it also helps us in identifying key facial features, such as, say, the coordinates of a left eye or right eye, or the smiling probability, which for this picture would be zero, of course. Apart from that, it also helps us in getting the contours of the face. What is the contour of a face? Anyone? Any rough idea? Anyone else? Sorry? Yes, kind of. Anyone else who want to try? Sorry? So what do you have? Mm-hmm. Contours are continuous lines which represent the borders of a face, that is the oval shape. Apart from that, also represents the curved lines in the eyebrows or the lips and the nose bridge. So the contours are basically a list of points that we can get from the API. Also, the API is capable of tracking faces in, say, real-time camera feed or videos. Now, suppose instead of a single face, we have a group of faces. So in that case, we get a list of faces where each face is wrapped in an object type face, like very much understandable. And the coordinates could be assumed as the attributes out here. So now let's look into how we can implement it in Flutter. Sorry. So since we are dealing with images, we need to get an image from the device. So what is the plugin that we can use to get an image? Any Flutter developer? Yes? Yes. So we can use Image Picker library to get an image from a gallery or directly get it clicked from the camera. For now, let's assume that whole of this functionality is wrapped up inside getImage file. So we are just calling it and finally storing the image in a variable called image file. Next, we need to create a Firebase Vision image object out of it. So we do that using Firebase vision image.from file and passing in the file that we have used as a parameter. After this, we need to create an instance of a face detector. So of course, we again have a function for this, that is firebase.instance.facedetector. And now, since we have the image and since we have the detector, we just need to pass the image, that is the vision object that we have created earlier, using the instance of the face detector and using the function, that is process image. And thus, we are done. We get a list of faces that was detected wrapped inside a list, say faces. Now we can just iterate through it and get all the attributes of all the faces that was detected. So let's say we use a for loop, and then we get iterate through each of the face and get some attributes like, say, head Euler angle. It is used to get the angle of rotation of the face that was detected with respect to y-axis. Apart from that, we also get the coordinates of a left eye, or say what was the smiling probability of the face that was detected. And hence, we are done. Now, our Flutter application has the capability of detecting faces, and this is done with just a few lines of code. And at last, we release all the resources. So hence, we have used an application of our machine learning in our mobile application. Now let's see how this is serving a real world application. So Zile, it is an application that uses image analysis, that used image analysis models to detect faces and then return some special movements of a picture. Initially, they used their own model, but then it started lagging. And when the developers worked more on it, the size of the app went beyond 200 MB. And finally, they moved to Firebase ML Kit and now use face detection APIs and the image labeling APIs available out there. So the whole mechanism became very much simple. And the app was shrunk by 50% approximately. And this also helped the developers because they can concentrate more on other prime features. So that is all I had for today. Thank you so much for having the patience to learn, for having the patience to listen. So if you want to connect with me, you can use my LinkedIn profile. You can follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is @BhadaniRimjhim. You can read my blogs. You can look at my repositories. It has some projects where I have used Firebase ML Kit and Flutter. Also, you can reach out to me on Gmail. If you have any problem in locating any of my social handles, you can just Google search Rimjhim Bhadani, and I hope you get all my handles. So that is all. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, we are taking it off stage.